So very good evening to all. First of all, thank you to Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society Scientific Committee led by the dynamic Dr. Ragini for the opportunity. After a very busy day of hardcore academics, this is the end of the day session, but this is also equally important and a topic which perhaps has not been discussed as much as it should be. So we're going to have a roundtable discussion on how to go about managing any professional society. We're going to have some brainstorming. We have a fantastic lineup of very eminent faculty. So what is this session all about? As members of various professional associations, we become a select group of professionals. However, what do these associations have to offer for its members? Organizing meetings, conferences, and publishing periodicals are some of the common activities. But to what end? Can there be more goals than that are relevant to our times for any professional association? This IC will discuss amongst office bearers of various associations, past and present, as to how to realign, refocus, and reinforce such associations for the current needs and demands of its members. I'm going to introduce the eminent faculty. First and foremost, Dr. Kuresh Maskati, who has been the past president of associations like AIOS, MOS, the Cornea Society, Bombay Ophthalmic Association, and ISMICS. He is the chairman of the SARC Pediatric and Strabismus Association and is the recipient of Lifetime Achievement Award from ISCARIS. Dr. Prakash Marathe, who is a senior vice president, IMA, Maharashtra State. He's a managing committee member of AIOS, executive trustee of Pune Ophthalmic Society and IMA. He's the chairman of Maharashtra chapter of ISMICS. He's the president of ACOIN Maharashtra and has been the president of MOS, IMA Pune and Pune Ophthalmological Society. Dr. Santosh Bhide, who is the second vice president of MOS, who has been the past president of Pune Ophthalmological Society and past president of ISMICS. Dr. Milind Kiledar, who is the president of Ophthalmologist Social Association Sangli, who has been a past president of MOS, a joint organizing secretary of MOS Sangli Conference in 2000, and he's an eminent pediatric ophthalmologist from Sangli. Dr. Madhav Ambekar, who is an ophthalmologist in private practice in Jalna, a second generation ophthalmologist, and who has been active in various fora in the state and national level. Dr. Manish Bapai, who is a vitreoretina, cataract, and refractive surgeon from Nasik, a prolific publisher who has published 100 presentations with 100 presentations with 9 publications and has won multiple awards at various fora. Dr. Rajesh Joshi, who is the joint secretary of Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society, who has been the past president of Vidarbha Ophthalmological Society, a past chairman of scientific committee of VOS, and who serves as the professor at the Government Medical College, Nagpur. And I am going to anchor this session. I have served as the past secretary of POS and also as past secretary of scientific committee of MOS. And presently, I'm editor of the Blink periodical from MOS. So let's start with the first question. And I would throw this question to Dr. Marathe. What is the relevance of any professional association, organization, or society in today's times?
Hello. Good afternoon, all of you. And I am traveling and sorry if there is any disturbance in the connectivity. Am I audible?
Yes.
I think professional associations, they are the things which are united to all members of that particular society. Like specialty associations are taking care of scientific activity of that particular subject, then brotherhood amongst the members is being increased. And there are various issues like at government level, corporation level, various laws, rules and regulations which are regulating to doctors and medical profession, which is quite troublesome for medical fraternity nowadays. And there is one more association which is not directly the specialty organization, but it is the Indian Medical Association. Though scientifically we are more related to specialty associations, the associations like Indian Medical Associations, they are taking care of all the problems of medical fraternity, taking them to government level, corporation level, and all the rules and regulations which are being thrown upon the medical fraternity, and the chances of harassment are more. So suppose you are a very busy practitioner, very good practice, and you think that you are the successful practitioner, but in today's era that is not so. You are related to so many rules, regulations by the governments, and you need to be associated with various organizations. Your problems are taken care of by them. Like nowadays, there is problem of violence. Then new rules like COVID era, you must have faced all of them. Like hospital resistance. You need to be communicated with various organizations. And in today's era, no connection.
I think there is some problem with the connectivity with Dr. Marathe. In the meanwhile, I would throw this question to Dr. Maskati sir as well. So if you could.
Yeah, see, there are traditionally, as Mandar has explained, traditionally our associations like the AIOS, POS, BOA, MOS have been concentrating on delivering scientific education to their members, publishing journals, peer-reviewed journals and things like that. I think these will continue to be relevant, but we really, really need to have a different role. We need to chart a parallel role for our organizations, and that is in lobbying. We need to be very professional, and there's no shame in it. The problem is that we feel that employing lobbyists and paying money to them is shameful when we can represent our case. The government or the authorities don't listen to us. So American Academy of Ophthalmology, which is so big and with so many members, they pay hundreds of thousands of dollars. I mean, they can afford it, but they have professional lobbyists in their Congress, in their Senate, to put forward their point of view. And I think on some lower scale, we need to have that in all our associations. IMA is trying its best, but IMA is a very huge organization with different pulls and pressures in different areas. So IMA Haryana may be doing something with IMA Maharashtra may be against what Haryana is doing. So we need to have local level, like our MOS needs to have lobbyists.
Very true. Would Dr. Bide like to opine about this?
I think Santosh has gone to another hall.
Dr. Rajesh, would you like to express your opinion regarding this?
Yes, I think joining organization is not the top priority, which I suppose, because those people who have worked day and night with patients may have limited time for organization, but there is definitely relevance in joining the organization, like achieve common goals through people to people or people to work relationship. It creates cohesiveness between the people. Imagine a person who hasn't joined any organization and he just sits in his clinic and goes home. There is nothing to communicate with his colleagues. So it helps in communication with the people also. It creates transparency. Important to bring out constitutional changes in the constitution. I think that is the relevance of organization in today's era.
Dr. Ambekar, would you like to give your opinion? Is Dr. Madhav Ambekar around?
Yeah, I'm here. Sorry that I joined a bit late because of the net connection issues. Are you getting me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Then definitely. See, the organization is absolutely required, but it needs a lot of other parameters why to join the organization. And what you have written in your abstract, I think that is the current relevance for the organization. But definitely, it has to be followed by almost everyone. Why almost? Well, it has to be followed by everyone. That is mandatory. But in the current backdrop, which is not seen that sometimes it goes more on a political scenario, which should not happen.
No, why should a youngster today join the organization? What is the organization giving?
What this Dr. Rajesh Joshi has said, because initial some part I have missed in as I joined a bit late, but Rajesh has said that if you are in the clinic and going back home without getting any communication, because what is required is in a difficult situation in the patient management is there. The organization is there that if you send it, like what most of the times is happening on especially ophthalmic discussion group, that we get to know any problems which are there. And especially when Kuresh is there, you guide us in many situations. So that is one reason. Apart from that, what else can we do?
You see, there are many, many WhatsApp groups where don't insist on whether you're a member of an organization or not. You can still be a member of a WhatsApp group which is scientific. Unfortunately, that is happening now. So they get their information. They communicate with colleagues. They do everything without being a member of MOS or POS or anything.
No, but then if there is an organ, if you are a member of the organization, if there are any policy matters for that particular profession, like an ophthalmologist, if these policy matters are to be taken put forth for the policymakers at the government level or any administration level, I think organization only will work as a single person. It will not be possible to do this all.
Madhav, I'm just playing devil's advocate. But if I am not a member, I will still get the benefit of whatever policy things that you people do. You are great guys. You will appeal to the government. You will give me, you will get a lot of benefits. All the chocolates will come to me also. That's as a non-member.
Fine. Yes, I agree on that also. But finally, you
I'm telling you, this is the reason when I talk to youngsters, telling them to become a member of MOS, I find this issue, sir, why? Why? What am I gaining? Everything is available on the net. If I want to read the journals, Indian Journal of Ophthalmology, even AIS. Sir, IJO is open. It's a free journal. I can read the IJO on the net. So I get up to date with the news. Google is there to help me for everything else. So I get my information. I am in WhatsApp groups, which are there where I'm, say, if I'm a retina person and there are retina WhatsApp groups which are available. With, don't ask me whether you're a member of VRSI or whatever. They take me in. So I get everything that I need. Main kyun life membership ki fee kyun bhar?
I think you are a social, you means a person is a social, has to be a social.
Yeah, he's enjoying the laughter, he's enjoying the science, everything on WhatsApp groups. You see, so I'm answering my own question. The thing is that we need to be a little selective even in our WhatsApp groups to make sure that only members are there in our groups. Number one, we need to isolate people who are non-members. Don't give them a stage. Don't give them a place. For example, like in an MOS meeting, of course, but even in district meetings or wherever, it starts from small level, from district level, and we need to motivate them to become a member of the district society. And then motivate all the district members to become a member of MOS. So it has to be a sort of domino effect starting from the district. And only then will we get everyone to become a member. Because in district, there is Sharma Sharmi. If there are only 11 people in Buldana district, for example, you can easily convince those 11 people to become a member of Buldana Ophthalmic Society. Because there is a pariah effect of being left out in a small society. Then you say that Buldana Ophthalmic is paying the money to MOS for everybody to become a member of MOS. Oh, chal jata hai. I think something like that we have to do. I'm talking about drastic ways to double the strength of the MOS within a year.
No, but then do you think that people do not join just on the grounds of the amount which is spent to become a member? No.
No. It's just the apathy. Humko kyun kya karna hai? Itna sab organization. I have to join IMA. I have to join. For example, if it's a Bombay person, he has to join IMA, Bombay Ophthalmic, Maharashtra Ophthalmic, AIOS. Hey, itna sab kyun karu? I'll join one. Chalo, BOA ko join kar liya. Bas bahut ho gaya.
Yeah, so this is exactly the next question, that if one is a member of one professional organization, association, then what is the relevance to join multiple associations? So this is exactly what Dr. Maskati sir is saying. And I think this is a I wouldn't say it's a problem, but it's a thing which youngsters particularly don't relate to. And I would pass on this question first to Dr. Marathe sir, because he heads IMA and many other ophthalmic societies. So what's your opinion Thank about you. this question?
Thank you, Dr. Mandar. I think what I answered for the first question, was I totally completely audible or the connection got
No, unfortunately, your voice was not very audible.
Okay. Now it is okay?
Yes.
I think the associations, for example, when we go to government, what government is asking, how many doctors are there, allopathy doctors are there in Maharashtra? Suppose the strength is more than 1 lakh. They ask us the question as IMA Maharashtra, you are coming to us. How many IMA Maharashtra members are there? We tell them around 50,000. What they say, you with you. In that case, what government wants the numbers from our associations. So we should be able to convince our colleagues that the issues for you, which are to be sorted out with government, and that is for betterment of medical fraternity and for solving your issues, why don't you become members? Because to sit in the clinic and do your own private practice, that is not the only thing which is needed nowadays. I think government, corporation, and all those rules and regulations by government, they are trying to trouble doctors. They are trying to trouble medical fraternity. Unless we are united and unless we are there to means oppose them in that way, when they are forming wrong rules and regulations, only the unity stands. And where at that point of time, the associations, like suppose you are a member of Ophthalmic Association, and in addition to that, you are becoming member of IMA, that is going to help you, because associations like MOS are taking care of scientific upgradation of knowledge of members, whereas body like IMA is trying to fight with government and corporation and various government dealings for unnecessary implementation of rules and regulations and troubling the medical fraternity. So that is the role why one should become member of more than one association. That's what I feel.
Yes, very true. There are many, many problems which we face in our practice, in establishing a practice or hospital. And only when you face a problem, then you want help from a professional organization, somebody to stand behind you.
So one more thing, like issues like medical legal this thing, violence, where professional bodies most of the times are not taking more interest in that. Associations like IMA are there just to save you from these bad implications of rules, where the membership of that association matters a lot.
Very true. I would also put this question to Dr. Milind Kiledar, given his experience. What's your opinion, sir, about this? Sir, can you unmute yourself?
Yes. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. See, these totally the functions of these organizations is totally different. I would take up help of IMA for any local issues, local problems, like social attacks, people attacking a particular clinic or patients becoming rowdy, then IMA can come to help. Then solving issues like with ethical committees, which MOS has and all, that MOS will definitely help. And national level, of course, it cannot help you individually, but being a member of national association will be of pride, and definitely it will be very good to have a membership of a national association. So I would set all three different goals for becoming member of three associations.
Okay. Would Dr. Maskati like to comment on this, sir?
No, I think what Prakash has said, what Milind has said is true. Only issue is that it doesn't translate. These are the lofty goals that we all have as members of this illustrious panel. The problem is trying to convince the youngster who's starting practice to become a member of four organizations all at once. And I think we should do it gradually over time, rather than pushing him to start on the day he starts his practice. He should become a member of Bombay Ophthalmic, MOS, IMA, and EIOS. So we should be done gradually, but we should make attempts to get everyone in the fold. As Dr. Marathe said, the strength is in numbers. Everyone looks at numbers. When you want to appeal to government or authorities, they want to know how many is your strength.
Yeah, very true,
you want
sir.
To create a pressure group only.
Yes.
Finally, what yes, Marathe sir had said.
So we our generation belongs to the pre-communication era, the fast communication era. So probably we relate to person-to-person contact more as compared to the present generation, which is growing up on fast communication platforms. And probably they don't feel the need to communicate personally till they have a problem. And that is when they probably feel the need to take help from professional bodies. But then I think it is important to be in touch. So it's like if you're friends with somebody, if you're going to call him up once in 10 years, probably that friendship has little meaning. But as against maybe calling at least once in 6 months or once in a year, if not in 6 months. We move on to the next question. So I would like to ask everyone and...
Dr. Mandar, can I interrupt you for a second?
Absolutely, absolutely, madam.
Good evening, Mandar. Thank you for this session. Good evening. I must first apologize to Dr. Prakash Marathe, sir, because it was really inconvenient for him to join today, but we are keeping him occupied the next weekend also. So, sir, first, sorry, and thank you.
No, madam, no need to say sorry, because it is very difficult for scientific committee chairman to accommodate all programs, all ICs, and everybody cannot be satisfied. So then I am moving on in the vehicle as IIMA activity, visit of IIMA Pune branches with
sir,
my state president. Dr. Lunde is there with me, state president. And I think MOS scientific program is also the priority for me. And I have contacted and communicated Dr. Mandar, and I am there, madam. No issues.
Sir, thank you. Apologies once again. Good evening, Kuresh sir, my mentor, my guru, Madhav Bhaiya, Dr. Milind Giledar, sir, and everybody, thank you and sorry for the interruption. Thank you so much, Mandar Dada, again for this wonderful IC. Maskari, sir, good evening.
Good evening.
I have a talk in the SICA session. Actually, I should be here with all my mentors and gurus here, but may I excuse myself?
Sure.
Good evening, madam.
Sorry, Mandar, for the interruption.
No problem.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
So we move on to the next question. What are the important and new opportunities that any professional organization need to seek? And I would throw this question to Dr. Santosh Bide. You can start with this question.
Yeah, good evening. Sorry for joining late because I had to give one talk in that another SICS session. I have missed first few questions. First thing is that organization is most important for everybody. And we have understood this during these COVID times. The new opportunities, there are many new opportunities actually. Like last year, what we did was a group professional indemnity. Second thing is that a very good concept of family benefit scheme, which is being done by All India Ophthalmological Society. It's very good for all the members to be part of the association and to get involved in this. There are many other things, like there will be more challenges which we as a practitioners are going to face in future. Like when we started practice, maybe around 20, 30 years ago, we had less challenges. And as the days go, days are going to be there, there will be more legal hassles and many problems, and in which an organization is going to help the members. So I feel that we have to be a part of professional organization, and there will be lot many opportunities to the professional organization in future.
I want to ask this question to Dr. Rajesh as well, because now you'll be in the saddle from the 1st of November. So how do you look at exploring new opportunities, particularly in relevance to MOS?
Yeah, definitely. There are various new opportunities like online resources, like... if you see the website of ASCRS or AIOS website, there is a column like members only. So you have that access to all the members or all the data. There are various web links which are created on the website. So you can access those websites. You can access those link whenever you want. Networking opportunities. You can connect with your friends or with your peers through these websites. Provisional professional development, like fellowships, which may be short-term or long-term, or teaching courses. I remember a few years back, there was an opportunity for youngsters to join short-term fellowship at various hospitals. So that is another opportunity which the organization can provide. Communication skills. It definitely develops communication skills as you are first time it happens that if you go on to the podium, you may have difficulty in speaking. But once you communicate with people, definitely you develop a communication skill. Education and discounted publications. This is another opportunity. Like MOS has got its journal, JCOR. So you can publish your work into these journals. Resume Builder. Whenever you are submitting biodata, definitely you write down that I'm a member of AIOS or MOS or something like that. And it improves your biodata also. Job opportunities on job hunting. I remember a few years back, AIOS has posted some job opportunities at various hospitals. So that is another opportunity which can be looked for. Finding your passion. Nowadays, singing competition, Rangoli competitions, they are being organized at MOS level or AIOS level. So you can find your passion. And of course, health and indemnity insurances. That is another opportunity which organization gives to. So I think these are the various opportunities organization can give to various people.
Yeah, very well said, Dr. Rajesh. I would also...
Can I add one thing here?
Yes, sir.
I think what Dr. Rajesh has said, various things which one organization can do, this relates either way. Like, suppose the organization, there are various district societies and there are various organizations like MOS, AIOS. Unless the society and association is vibrant, working with new ideas, new membership, I think the name of the organization should be very nice amongst members, that the association is really good taking care of its members. If the association is stagnant and not working for its members, probably it is not the good association. So association should also take care of itself, that it is a nice organization, and updation of that particular association should be done by office bearers of that particular thing. Thank you.
Dr. Manish, can you opine about this question? Dr. Manish Bapai?
I think Dr. Rajesh has elucidated all the benefits and the opportunities that professional organizations can offer to people who are members. I think if youngsters are going to join the organization, or why should they be joining the organization, all these things which are already been said. However, there is something else that we already have in MOS, if I'm not wrong, is the mentorship programs, because the things that can help juniors is setting up ORs, setting up instruments, getting instruments. So if we have mentorship programs where the where anyone can go, see, what's happening is a lot of people are doing FACO fellowships where they're paying per case, learning to do FACO, but that's not the end of FACO surgery. It's about which machine to purchase, how to set up OT, where to find resources. And these FACO fellowship programs, everybody just wants to do surgery, but the rest of the things, they start facing problem afterwards. If somebody, new member is joining, a fresh person is joining, or even somebody who's in practice, wants to have, who's setting up new hospital, they can have direct mentorship programs, which can be offered to members, where they can go and, you know, I want to go and see, for example, Muscati sir's clinic. So we should be able to do that. Though they can do on personal basis, this can be, if it is brought out through membership, I mean, you know, through the membership or through the organization, that gets more formalized, that can, when more and more people come, we can do those things also. I think next question is about the research, but other opportunity which I think in MOS we can definitely explore is collating the data. There are some people who are very good in writing papers. A lot of us are good at doing surgeries, clinically very good, but writing papers and collecting data, collating it is a art, and you know, it needs, you need to train yourself in doing that, which unfortunately our fellowship and postgraduate programs do not do it to the extent that it should be done. But there are people who are doing it. So that is another opportunity which can be offered to new members. we can discuss it in this.
Yes, yes. Some very important points have been brought up, especially about the development of a person as a whole, as a personality. And I think it does not happen in isolation. It happens in a group because we are a social animal. So we need to connect with our own peers to understand, to learn, and to grow. So I think that that aspect needs to be remembered when we are joining a professional association. So now coming to a very important thing, and which Dr. Maskati sir had already elucidated to, is the lobbying part, but I have put it in a little more formal way. So what are the important advocacy issues that associations like us need to or should pursue, especially given the negative opinion about doctors in general in the present time? I would request Maskati sir to express his opinion.
I think it's a very good question. And as I said right in the beginning, we need to have a good PR team, lobbying team. So first of all, this PR team, we pay them. And we had toyed with this idea in BOA, but it didn't come about, but maybe through MOS, that we have a PR team, a public relations team whom we pay. They get us positive publicity. They get us space in newspapers, which is not an advertisement. So, see, many eye surgeons advertise themselves. They purchase space. We know that newspapers can be bought. So they purchase space and then they write about their phaco machines or their wonderful work or that they got this award or that award. But so that is taken by the public also with a pinch of salt because they know that it is purchased. But if a PR team does it for an association and writes about, you know, the insurance crisis, why cashless is bad for consumers, something like that. So they want to change public opinion about doctors. Why doctors are not crooks, all doctors are not crooks, highlighting some of the eye camps we do, highlighting some of the good work that we do, even without mentioning names of doctors. As an association, it highlights the good work that MOS is doing, for example. It's, according to me, worth every penny that we can pay them. That is step one. Step two would be another team, which is a lobbying team, which may be different from the PR team, is a lobbying team which lobbies with the government, telling them about how certain restrictions in the Nursing Home Act, are not applicable. Our Daycare Act, why it should be passed. So, you know, we are trying our best going through lawmakers. But if there is a public opinion build up, then lawmakers also will find it easy to implement, saying even public is for this. So something like this, where we build up public opinion, it's not, Rome was not built in a day. It may take 5 years for it to take effect, but paying for 5 years may help us for a lifetime.
Very well said, sir. And I think the powers that be in the future, Dr. Rajesh Joshi and Dr. Santosh Bhide, take note of this, because this is a very important aspect. We don't represent ourselves enough in the corridors of power. And therefore, our voice is not heard on one side. And in the public domain, we know what impression we have in general as professionals. And I think we need to change that. And what Dr. Maskati sir has said is extremely, extremely important.
I fully agree with the views of Dr. Maskati sir and others. But unfortunately, in the politician's mind, we as a doctors are not voters, because the number of doctors is very less. It's 0.01%. So they treat us like you are not their voting bank. So though they need us, they don't treat us properly. But I think point well taken. I think Maskati sir has given good suggestions.
We can
project our good work to the public, like so many eye camps everybody is doing, free surgeries all over Maharashtra everyone is doing. And like cashless is not good. That has to be projected in a proper fashion. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, Manish.
One more addition. Oh, sorry.
Yes.
Yes, I will come to you. Yeah, Manish, please.
Yeah. So you asked what advocacy issues that we need to take up. I think most of the two issues which are, I think, are very pertinent or important today is PCP NDT for ophthalmology, which really doesn't make much sense. That already has been tried by Pune Ophthalmic, if I'm not wrong, but it didn't work out. Second is daycare for the ophthalmic hospitals, which again, we as MOS have taken up the issue. But I think this needs to be pursued, the especially PCP entity, because the daycare issue is being pursued. We are aware of all that, of that activity, and it will be pursued. But PCP entity also we need to fight. And I beg to differ with Dr. Maskati sir, is very senior about the cashless. Cashless is here to stay. Let's accept that. If a powerful organization like BOA can probably fight it, but we in small cities will not be able to fight, sir. Because a patient who's in Borivali will not go to Mulund, this hospital, the hospital which offers cashless. If there is a corporate hospital which is offering cashless, a person from Borivali won't get up and go to Mulund. But in Nasik, where you can travel from one place to another in 20 minutes, he will definitely go. So rather than telling patients cashless is not good, which is not going to it's not going to be of help. Rather, we should be forming a body together and asking for better remunerations per case. And the discrimination that happens if you are from small city, if you have smaller hospital, the ophthalmic hospitals are not going, 10 bed ophthalmic hospital is huge. I mean, we don't need it. But there is discrimination which happens based on these things. So I think we as MOS and even at AIOS level, that is an issue which we need to take up with insurance companies and probably organizations.
Manish, I would like to add one thing.
We are also asking for just three things from the cashless. One is that all people who want to be included should get included. Number two, there should be co-pay. And number three, there should be a redressal mechanism for grievances. Once that is there, BOA will join. So we are talking on the same line. We are all in the same length. We don't want to stop cashless. We want to improve cashless.
Actually, everyone should be allowed to do cashless. Why there are only preferred few who are doing cashless?
So these are the issues we need to form pressure group and
those who are members of associations like All India Ophthalmic Society or MOS, everybody should be allowed to do cashless. And we should get a better pay, like co-pay has to be there. So these two things we can, as an association, fight. Why only few select are allowed to do cashless?
These are just the same points, Santosh, on which BOA is fighting. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, Marathe sir, you wanted to say something.
So, yeah, I think when we were discussing about politicians' role, am I audible?
Yes.
I think we were discussing about politicians' role. One of my observations is, in the past, like 25 years ago, no politician was daring to stare at doctor, and they were not troubling doctors at all, or hospitals for that matter. Nowadays, because of these issues, what government is trying to pressurize medical fraternity, we have to go to politicians like ministers, corporators and politicians for hospital registrations, for not implementing proper laws and troubling doctors. We have to go to politicians again and again. Because of that, I think they are taking us for the ride. And the importance of medical profession, which was there in the past, like no politician was daring to trouble doctor. Nowadays, probably they are taking medical profession on ride. And this is the worst situation, unfortunately, in our country. The laws are prepared by the government, which is run by politicians. Those are not educated. Those are not knowing that particular knowledge of medicine. And they are preparing the laws, they are implementing the laws, and where medical profession is not taken into consideration while drafting the law, and hence the problem is getting critical day by day. That is my observation.
Sir, just IMA has a bigger role now. IMA will be having a bigger role in that.
Yes. We are trying hard on that.
Before we end this,
shall I talk for a...
Yes.
Please. I think what Dr. Quraish has said is, that's the only point, that a positive publicity, we need to have a perfect PR team. See, cashless and everything comes under what Dr. Marathe sir has said, that about the pressure tactic groups and everything as part of the policy. But then finally, see, most of the places, what is happening, even at the local level or wherever, doctors are all sitting for looting. See, that is amongst the society members, most of the times. So unless there is a PR group which is there to have a positive publicity, see, case by case basis, it may not be possible. But if there is someone who keeps writing regularly about the positive things happening as a columnist, I think that should serve overall, because in the recent past, even from the higher government also, there were some comments that the doctors are, I mean, it was implying that the doctors are there to make money only. But finally, see, every doctor is also part of the society. He also should make a reasonable money. But for that, the negative publicity part, which was appearing in the newspaper, was never countered by any society specifically to protect the doctors at large. That there are areas where doctors are doing good job also. In fact, good job is done by at many a times than this kind of a negative thing, but which is not given a proper publicity. So which is, I think even Dr. Santosh, who is now coming in, I think try to find out some columnists who can keep properly writing about the happenings overall.
Yeah, Dr. Rajesh, before we go to Dr. Santosh, Dr. Rajesh, you wanted to say something?
I have just a small point to make. In fact, whatever Maskati sir, Bhide sir and Ambikar sir has said, that is perfect. But whenever we are, this is regarding image building, I suppose, whatever question Dr. Mandar has asked, that is,
your connection seems to be a little weak. We are not able to hear your voice very clearly.
Image building. And whenever we are celebrating push, we should push. Is it clear?
Yes.
It is clear.
Is it clear? Yeah, whenever
yes,
we are
clear. Yes.
Whenever we are celebrating Adoration Fortnight or Glaucoma Week, we should make them aware that we are doing this awareness things also. We are operating, we are seeing patients, it will create a positive impact on their mind. And definitely that will help in image building also.
Yeah. In the interest of time, I think we'll move on to the next question.
Yeah.
We as a professional association of ophthalmologists specifically, I feel we are a great platform for facilitating or conducting research, and which Dr. Manish had earlier referred to. So I would put this question first to him. How do you think an organization like MOS can facilitate in conducting research at an association level? Dr. Manish. Manish, you are muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think there are workshops being conducted on how to write the papers and how to collect data, how to analyze. So that though these are excellent steps which are already taken, I think the area where we can improvise on is probably collecting data and publishing together. So for example, I'm a part of European Vitreoretina Society, and every year they come up with a program or come up with a topic where the paper is being published, which is collection of the data on specific topic. So 1 year there was rheumatogenous retinal detachment, other was macular hole and things like that. So the similar opportunities I think can be generated in MOS as well. Because there are we see similar kind of patients in different specialties. So I think there are, as I was referring to, there are people who are very good in writing the papers and publishing, which is not something comes naturally to each and every one of us. So mucormycosis times, there were multiple papers which were published by oculoplasty group. Dr. Akshay Nair from Mumbai, he has collated data from various people in India and published very good papers in American Society and international journals. So such people who are capable of doing it, they can take charge, they can collect data, and you know, this would also help us learning in the process. So the youngsters, that can also be a thing, that you know, if you are part of the group, you can have a authorship in one of these if you maintain the data properly and give it for as a collated data. So, and we can really come up with very good papers with very large sample sizes. So this is what I think we can do.
I'll pass on this question to Dr. Killedar as well. What would you say about it, sir?
Yeah, I think this was mucormycosis was a very classic example, but we can always take up multicentric studies, which we definitely lack in, especially in Maharashtra. We have so many centers on a particular topic. We can have multicentric studies, trials, and that can give a very good data.
Very true. Given the collective power of our members in various subspecialties, I think we should harness this to conduct research on a wider scale. And would Dr. Rajesh like to add something given his interest in research and publication? Dr. Rajesh, you're muted.
If you see at a local level, there is always a problem with ethical issues. If an individual doctor wants to conduct a study, there is always a problem in getting ethical approval. So how to get about this? How to get an ethical approval from the medical colleges or from big organization? MOS, or in fact, a local organization can help or can help this individual doctor in getting ethical approval. Because writing would be easy sometimes than getting an ethical approval. Then supporting the member having interest in research, that is also very important. MOS can act as a thread between the doctors who are interested and may act as a collaborators with different hospitals for conduct of large size study, which can be published in future. That is what I want to add about this research and all.
What Dr. Manish has said is very correct, that at this organizational level, if you formulate certain study with how to collect the data and everything and try to have an appeal to the members, saying that this is the data which is required. So those centers which are having the infrastructure for collecting that particular data, I think they can become the part. And every year at MOS level also, we can publish that data. Manish has come out with a very novel idea. This is really a very, very fantastic idea to have such kind of a collaborative activity at a society level.
I think one important point is Dr. Rajesh. Yes, sir.
I may just add to what everyone has been saying is that another thing is that many people in smaller places have huge volumes of patients,
yes,
but they have no clue as to how to write a paper. And even if they write a paper, it is rejected several times because maybe their English is faulty or their writing style is not in the style of the journal. Every journal wants a particular style, or they can't quote references the way the journal wants them to quote. So for technical reasons, though their data is excellent, if they get, so if MOS or something like that can have a small committee of people who are good writers, some people like Rajesh or anybody, you know, who have written papers in the past. So the youngster who wants to write sends the raw data or sends a written paper to him first. And then Rajesh polishes those edges, tells him what is wrong, tells him to rewrite. So instead of the editor rejecting it, Rajesh, I'm just using Rajesh as a name. Rajesh rejects it, but rejects it in a very nice manner and tells him, better you do these things, correct this and come back to me. And you know, our 3-4, and then he says, when Rajesh says it is all right, now send it for publication. The chances of that youngster getting it published is so much 100 times higher. So yes, that is somewhere where our association, by forming a small public publication help committee or something, can really, really help youngsters who have never published before. And leave this is only for those who want to, for their first publication. So a youngster who has published in the past, we don't help because the committee will get flooded. But anybody who has never published and wants to publish, this is the committee to go to help get that first publication in.
Yeah, just something a few like points.
Mentoring the youngsters, something like that.
Very true, very true. Yeah. So just a few facts that the amount of publications at the national level or international level from an association like MOS, which has nearly 3,000 members, is not very encouraging. And I think we need to really put our heads together to do something about it. And what the important point which Dr. Rajesh mentioned was about the ethical committee.
Yes,
ethical committee is a roadblock. There is no doubt about it. But I think we can probably MOS as an association can think of forming an ethical committee, maybe at zonal level or something like that. I know it's not easy. I know it's medical legally not.
Rules are such that you cannot have ethical committee of your own. Like even some private hospitals.
No, also as an association, I'm not talking of individual ethical committees. I'm talking of
even as an association. Even as an association, you cannot have your ethical committee.
So that is one more advocacy point that I think we can take up if you want to increase the research potential of the research work that we've been doing or we can do potentially as an association. We'll move on to the next question. We know that Maharashtra is a large state like our country. I'm just taking Maharashtra as an example. So what way can professional associations help doctors and practitioners in the remote area? I will start with Dr. Ambekar, sir, if you could just express your opinion about this. So you're muted.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. See, as far as the remote area is concerned, like what Maratha sir is right now traveling as an IMA member, IMA president, to various places. So similar way, such kind of meetings can be organized. And the last year, the scientific committee has done the same thing, that given an opportunity to the district level societies to have the webinars, where the sponsors for webinar was the searched by MOS only, but then the host societies were the local district societies. So similar way, that will be definitely of help. And if such platform is available, to have problems sorted out, say on a periodic basis. It was on a weekly basis. So similar way, weekly or fortnightly meetings are there. And one session conducted sitting by the panelist for one specific subject. I think anybody having such kind of a problem in the remote areas where the access is not that easy or solving the questions may not be that easy. Obviously, in the current backdrop when most of the things are available on the net, I think this may have slightly less relevance, but then communication will have a better understanding amongst the doctors to solve out the problems. That is what I feel.
Would Dr. Killedar like to say something about this, given that he is practicing not in a remote area, but he does have patients from remote areas? So
definitely, professional associations can support help groups, which can in turn help these practitioners from remote areas, and many of the problems of remote area doctors can be sorted out at district levels, and that coordination can be done by professional association.
Dr. Marathe, you, when you were president of MOS, you traveled across the state. I think you visited all the districts in Maharashtra.
What's your experience? I think when I visited Maharashtra in my tenure as president, my idea was like there are various districts like Nandurbar or for that matter Kokan area where MOS was not percolated in the past. Like in Ratnagiri, Sindhudurga, I was fortunate to form associations of that particular districts, and even places like Nandurbar, there was no connectivity of MOS in the past. So my idea was to meet all districts, and various districts are different in that sense. Like bigger districts like Pune, Nagpur, Aurangabad, Mumbai, they had very strong associations of their own. But cities like small district societies where only 10-15 members were there, their motivation was needed by Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society. And what I tried to do that when they failed, that MOS president is visiting their place, they felt part of MOS. And I think motivating those members, taking them along with Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society was my motto. And I think I was successful in doing that. And in future, my future presidents of MOS also, they tried to continue the same tradition. And that way, all districts are getting connected nowadays. And I think this is the success what I expected. And definitely we are on the right track. But as Dr. Maskati sir, Dr. Ambekar sir, Dr. Killedar sir has said, probably the things like motivating members for scientific papers, like what we see in Western countries, when their papers are published and when they say that I have seen 10 patients. See, data of 10 patients can publish a paper in a nice format. whereas our clinicians see hundreds and thousands of patients. Unfortunately, we do not have the data. Like mucormycosis, which was there in Maharashtra and India, probably was the opportunity for our people. They treated that mucormycosis in a proper way. But what about documentation? I think we are lacking on this particular aspect, and hence publication in Maharashtra, in India for that matter, we are definitely lagging behind. The associations like MS must take this opportunity to guide our members to publish papers. And in the start only I said that association must be vibrant. They should come with new ideas. They should flourish with new concepts. And then members will get attracted towards these associations. Thank you.
This is the last question of this session. And I would quickly ask each one of you to express their opinion in brief. How do you groom future leaders? We know that there is a program at the national level, the AIS level, of leadership development program. Do you think such similar programs should be there at the state level as well? Maskati sir, you can start with this.
Yeah, Mandar, first of all, even the national program, the leadership development program is finding it's struggling to fill up the numbers for the LDP. So MOS can suggest leaders from our side to join the LDP. It's not that there is a clamor for it. And of course, we can have our own LDP programs, which are more suited to our state. So yes, there is a great opportunity. Also, the fact that we are a democracy and we are having elections now is a given for new members. But our association has come a long way. It is only since 1996 that we had elections. So only in the last 25 years, we've had elections. 25 years before that, there were no elections. So we are going forward. Elections and democracy is one way to revitalize the society. So the more the people who stand for elections, the better it is for the society. Thank you.
Dr. Bide, would you like to express your comments? Dr. Santosh Bide?
For grooming the leaders, no, future leaders. First thing is, as a leader, you have to identify who will be a good youngster who can take baton, you know. See, like association has to remain, and association has to remain in good hands. And we have to create a good association and give it to the future leaders. So whenever we are organizing some conference or some seminar at the local level, you come to know that who are really sincere, hardworking, and who really want to work for the association. So identify those people and encourage them, give them some position in the organization of future bigger conferences. And that's how you try and groom them. You know? Another point is that I would like to say is that one should not feel that if you don't get any particular post, then you should not feel that I'm useless or I'm not, the association doesn't need me or something like that. If you have a passion to perform and passion to work for the association, keep doing good work. There will be some time at which you will definitely get a good post and you will be able to do. So that's how we have to tell the youngsters also, because sometimes as a youngster, you feel that nobody needs me. I'm being neglected or I'm being sidelined, something like that. So at that time, you have to help that youngster. And like LDP programs are always good, but as Maskati sir has said that at all India level also, they are struggling. We can try LDP programs in our own state also. And we already have so many leaders, so they can also contribute, like Dr. Killedar, Dr. Madhav Ambedkar. They can also tell their views.
Yeah, I think leadership is all about setting examples. And we have very, very good leaders who have set examples by doing phenomenal work for the association at state, national, and even the international level. So I think that there is enough inspiration to follow those great leaders. I'm extremely sorry that we've run out of time.
No, I'll just have one word about this. See, as far as this is concerned, though it is a democratic society, but then can the criteria be there to say that unless you have one or two LDP programs done in the past run by the society, you should not be become eligible to contest the election even? Is it possible? Kuresh probably can be a better person to guide on this.
So though, I think
no, Madhav, as the constitution now stands, it is not possible, but you can always revise it in the future.
Yeah, no, not in the current bank.
Yeah.
No, let's go again also.
We already have criteria for contesting the elections, right? So if you want to contest for joint secretary or joint treasurer, you have to be a zonal member. So as it is, you grow through ranks only. You are not directly appointed as a joint secretary or joint treasurer.
You cannot become vice president without
unless you are a secretary treasurer or chairman scientific committee. You cannot become chairman scientific committee unless you are a member of scientific committee. Plus, you cannot become an editor journal. There are some strict guidelines for that also. So we already have put those guidelines. See, LDP program, there are many plus minuses also. Somebody may wish to join LDP program, but he may not get that opportunity. Then why deny that person of becoming a post holder in the association?
It was a wonderful session. I thank each and every panelist for their valuable time and the opinions that they have expressed. I also express a very happy festival season to all of you and to all the audience that have joined. And thank you to MOS Scientific Committee and Dr. Ragini Madam for giving us this opportunity. Thank you once again and goodbye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for involving us in this program. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mandar, for giving me the opportunity. I think I tried to do justice. And whatever the way,
thank you,
I could join. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mandar.
Thank you.
Thank you.